हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल सी पैरामेट्रिक क्यूबिक कर्व, ओके, देयर कंटिन्यूटी कंडीशंस एंड देयर इक्वेशंस इन मैट्रिक्स फॉर्मेट, एंड बेसिकली ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट आर द प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ द पैरामेट्रिक क्यूबिक कर्व. सो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड. The parametric cubic curve is also called as spline, and we all know how important the splines are in drafting technologies. So in drafting terminology, a spline is flexible strip used to produce a smooth curve through a designated set of points, and several small weights are distributed along the length of the strip to hold it in position on the drafting table as the curve is drawn. So an ancient way of creating curves was a steel rope or steel wire, or a rope used to be held between two points, and whenever you want to create a curvature, some weights used to attached in between, and because of the weights, the wire will be pulled towards the weights and we will get different shapes, okay, of curves. So that was the ancient way of creating curves. Okay, and same has been explained over here. Okay, but when we want to model this, okay, so we would require some equations, and then comes the mathematics of the curvature. So mathematically, spline is a curve with a piecewise cubic polynomial function whose first and second derivatives are continuous across the various curve sections. So when we are trying to draw curve mathematically, we are very much interested in finding the continuity of the curves at various points, and continuity also has different levels, okay, that we will see shortly. And in computer graphics, okay, the term spline curve refers to any composite curve formed with polynomial sections satisfying specified continuity conditions at the boundary of the pieces. Okay, so it is very important, as we have developed algorithms, studied algorithms which can display various geometric shapes. So it is also important to study what are the methods by which we can display the curves on the graphical output screen. So there are different ways, okay, how this can be achieved. So one way I just told you is interpolation. Interpolation is a method which we discussed by attaching weights to the wires, steel wires or metal wires. Okay, and pulling the metal wires towards the weight, and whatever shape gets formed is a polynomial curve that we call it. Okay, that is an interpolation way of doing it. But there is an approximate way of generating the splines, generating the curves. Okay, so the curves will probably pass from the starting point and the ending point, and in between points, they will only pull towards those points, but they will not actually pass through those points. Okay. So that is an approximate way of generating the splines. So we specify a spline curve by giving a set of coordinate positions called control points, which indicates the general shape of the curve. Okay, when polynomial sections are fitted so that the curve passes through each control point, the resulting curve is said to interpolate the set of control points, as I said. And when the polynomials are fitted to the general control point path without necessarily passing through any control point, okay, the resulting curve is said to approximate the set of control points. Okay, so this is the basic difference between the interpolation spline and an approximate spline. Interpolation curves are commonly used to digitize drawings or to specify animation paths. Approximation curves are primarily used as design tools to structure object surfaces. Okay, now till what degree we can interpolate the curve? Okay, we have some limitation with that, because we cannot have a curve which passes through n points. Okay, then what is going to be the order of that curve, and how exactly we are going to formulate that curve? Okay, but we can have a approximate way of creating the curve with n number of control points. Okay, so these are the basic differences between the two. Okay, so this is the interpolation curve. Okay, a set of six control points interpolated with piecewise continuous polynomial section. So each this point, okay, as you can see, is called as control point, and the curvature, the curve or the arc, is passing through each point. Okay, an example of this is a spline which we can draw on any 3D modeling tool. Okay, where you get a fairly good amount of control, okay, with each control point that you are drawing. Okay, and the next is the approximation spline. As you can see, the curve is not actually passing through any point, okay, any point, but it is just approximated towards the point. It is just like a control point is trying to pull the curve towards itself. Okay, a set of six control points approximated with piecewise continuous polynomial sections. Okay, there is a concept called as convex hull. Okay, whenever we draw a curve, okay, the curve follows certain properties, and one of the basic property of the curve is that it resides itself inside a convex hull. So a convex polygon boundary that encloses a set of control points is called as the convex hull. Convex hulls provide a measure for the deviation of a curve or surface from the region bounding the control points. Some splines are bounded by the convex hull, thus ensuring that the polynomials smoothly follow the control points without erratic oscillations. So the main purpose of convex hull to give stability to the curve and ensure that there are no erratic behaviors and the curve is not going outbounds. Okay, so they provide bounds to the curve, and that is a nice property to have. Also, the polygon region inside the convex hull is useful in some algorithms as a clipping region. So from the computer graphics point of view, okay, if we have to clip a certain curve, okay, from certain regions, okay, then the convex hull is going to help to form certain clipping regions. So as you can see over here, convex hull mostly is a closed polygon, okay, closed polygon, and which entirely bounds the curve inside, okay, inside to it. So a convex hull drawn where curvature is getting outside the boundaries of the convex hull is not actually a convex hull. Okay, it's not actually a convex hull. So convex hull, when you are saying all these dotted lines which are actually binding the curve inside the geometry, okay, that is what is called as convex hull. Similar to this, so I have control points over here, okay, the starting control point, the ending control point, and intermediate control points. Intermediate control points try to pull the curve towards itself, and starting and ending point are the points through which the curve actually passes through. Okay, then you have parametric continuity. Okay, so continuity of the curve is an essential property for joining the two curves together, and at what continuity level the curves are getting joined with each other. Okay, in order to identify that, the continuity condition is very essential condition for curve. So to ensure a smooth transition from one section of piecewise parametric curve to the next, we can impose various continuity conditions at the connection points. So it is helpful for composite curves. Okay, composite curves are basically joining two curves together, and with what kind of conditions those curves are joined together, that is defined by the continuity. If each section of a spline is described with a set of parametric coordinate functions of the form, let's say x equal to xu, y equal to yu, z equal to zu, where u1 is less than or equal to u less than or equal to u2, okay, we set parametric continuity by matching the parametric derivatives of adjoining curve sections at their common boundary. So depending on that, we have three levels, or basically more than three levels, but when we are dealing with the cubic curve, so three levels, okay, of continuity. So zero order parametric continuity, which is described as C0 continuity, which means simply that the curves meet, okay, the value of x, y, and z evaluated at u for the first curve section are equal respectively to the values of x, y, z evaluated at u for the next curve section. Say for example, a condition like this, where these curves only meet. So it is a zero continuity wherein the curves just meet, okay, at the common endpoint. So that is what we mean by zero order parametric continuity. The next condition is the first order parametric continuity, which is referred to as C1 continuity, which means that the first parametric derivatives, that is tangent lines of the coordinate functions, okay, in the equation that we just saw, okay, are equal at their joining point. So as you can see the example, so if I draw a tangent, okay, at this particular point, so it is going in this direction. The tangent of this next curve will also go in this direction, and their tangents are equal. That is, tangent is specified by the first parametric derivative. So from an equation point of view, okay, the first derivative at this point is equal for both the curves, and that is why their continuity is of the order 1, that is called as C1 continuity. Okay, and then I have a second order parametric continuity, which is called as C2 continuity, which means that both the first and second parametric derivatives of two curve sections are same at the intersection. Okay, so even the second derivative is also same, and they follow a same curvature. Okay, they follow a same curvature. So in first, that is the zero order continuity, that actually means the curves are meeting at common point. First order continuity means they have a common tangent, okay, at that point. And second order continuity means they share a common curvature at that point. Okay, so that is how the levels of continuity moves ahead, okay, by successively differentiating the equation and making them equal. Differentiating the equation and making them equal. So in the zero order continuity, there was no derivative. First order continuity, it is first derivative, okay, is equal. Okay, second order continuity means the second derivative is also equal, okay, at the intersection. And higher order parametric continuity conditions are defined similarly. So you can move ahead depending on the order of equation that curve is carrying. You can have, let's say, third order continuity, fourth order continuity, and so on. Now there are peculiar specifications of a spline. So three equivalent methods for specifying a particular spline representation. So we can state the set of boundary conditions that are imposed on the spline. Okay, then we can state the matrix that characterizes the spline, or we can state the set of blending functions, which are also called as basis functions, that determine how specified geometric constraints on the curve are combined to calculate positions along the curve path. Okay, so I have this equation wherein x of u is defined with ax multiplied by u cube plus bx into u square plus cx into u plus dx, where u is a parameter. That is why it is called as parametric representation of curve. So the parameter is going to vary between 0 and 1. Okay, and based on the powers which are specified in the equation. So boundary conditions for this curve might be set, for example, on the endpoint coordinates, which is x0 and x1, and on the parametric first derivatives at the endpoints, that is x-0 and x-1. Okay, x-0 and x-1. So x of 0 means x at u equal to 0, and x of 1 means x at u equal to 1. So this is a cubic equation. So that defines this particular curve is going to have four control points, okay, in which the first control point is going to be at u equal to 0. So that is x bracket 0, that is x at u equal to 0. And the last control point is going to be at u equal to 1. So that is x at u equal to 1. Okay. Now, if we want to define the boundary conditions, so we can define the endpoint coordinates as x0, x1. With the first derivatives of those endpoints at x-0 and x-1. So we can have these four boundary conditions, so that we can find the four unknowns, which are ax, bx, cx, and dx. Okay, so let's say I can convert this equation into a matrix equation in this manner. So x of u is a row matrix of one row and four columns, that is u cube, u square, u1, multiplied by a column matrix of four rows and one column. Okay, so I have u multiplied by c. Okay, u multiplied by c. So this m-jom is a four element column matrix containing the geometric constraint values, which basically are boundary conditions on the spline. And this M spline is a 4x4 matrix that transforms the geometric constraint values to the polynomial coefficients and provides a characterization for the spline curve. Okay, and in this, as you can see, this U is a row matrix of powers of parameters U, and C is a coefficient column matrix. And this C is basically given as M spline multiplied by M jom. Okay, and we can write the boundary conditions in matrix form and solve the coefficient matrix C. Okay, so I can eventually write x of u as u into m spline into m jom, Okay, the matrix M spline characterizing a spline representation sometimes is also called as basis matrix, and is particularly useful for transforming from one spline representation to another. Okay, so I can represent it as x of u is summation of k equal to 0 to 3. Why 0 to 3? Because it is a cubic spline. Okay, g of k multiplied by basis function of k of u. Okay, so polynomial representation for coordinate x in terms of the geometric constraint parameters, where g of k are the constraint parameters such as the control point coordinates and slope of the curve at the control point, and b f of k, okay, are the polynomial blending functions. So this class of spline is most often used to set up paths for object motions or to provide a representation for an existing object or drawing. But interpolation splines are also used sometimes to design object shapes. Okay, cubic polynomial offers a reasonable compromise between flexibility and speed of computation. Compared to higher order polynomials, cubic spline require less calculation and memory, and they are more stable. Compared to lower order polynomials, these splines are more flexible for modeling arbitrary curve shapes. So given a set of control points, cubic interpolation splines are obtained by fitting the input points with a piecewise cubic polynomial curve that passes through every control point. Suppose we have n plus 1 control points specified with coordinates. Let's say p is x of k, y of k, z of k, where k is 0, 1, 2 up to n. Okay, so I can write the equations, okay, separately for x, y and z as x of u as ax u cube plus bx u square plus cx u plus dx. Similarly, y is ay u cube plus by u square plus cy u plus dy, and similarly z of u is az u cube plus bz u square plus cz u plus d of z, where u is a parameter varying between 0 to 1, and I can have a curve representation in this manner. Okay, curve representation in this manner. So p0, p1, p2 up to pk, then p of k plus 1 up to p0. Okay, so we can describe the parametric cubic polynomial that is to be fitted between each pair of control points with the following set of equations. Okay, so with dpk and dpk plus 1 specifying the values for the parametric derivatives, which are slope of the curve at the control points pk and pk plus 1 respectively. Okay, so p of u is au cube plus bu square plus cu plus d, okay, which is basically a vector equivalent equation. Okay, the x component of p is given by x of u, and similarly for y and z components. So I can form a matrix equation of this sort. Okay, and I can form a slope equation of the same p of u as p dash of u. I will differentiate this with respect to u, okay, and form this equation where the derivatives of thin point function can be expressed as this. So I will have basically four boundary conditions. So p of 0, p of 1, which is given by pk, pk plus 1, and p dash of 0 and p dash of 1, which is given by dpk and dpk plus 1. This d basically stands for derivative of pk. Okay, so dpk means derivative of pk, dpk plus 1 means derivative of pk plus 1. Okay, so p of u represents a parametric cubic point function for the curve section between control points p of k and p of k plus 1. Then the boundary conditions are the Hermite curve section boundary conditions. Okay, so substituting these values, okay, endpoint values 0 and 1 for parameter u into the previous two equations, we can express the Hermite boundary conditions in the matrix form. So what are these? These are basically Hermite boundary conditions. So as you can see, I have here pk, pk plus 1, dpk, dpk plus 1. Okay, given by, these are the coordinate matrix, okay, coordinate matrix, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, then 0, 0, 1, 0, and 3, 2, 1, 0, multiplied by this A, B, C, D. Okay, so further, if I want to find the A, B, C, D, as we had seen over here, okay, now our aim is to find out these unknown parameters A, B, C, D. Okay, now what we have with us is this coordinate matrix and the boundary condition matrix on the left hand side. So what I'll have to do, I'll have to pre-multiply both sides by inverse of this coordinate matrix. Okay, pre-multiply both sides by inverse of this coordinate matrix. So that's what we are doing over here. Okay, so I pre-multiplied both sides by the inverse of this. So this got become the identity matrix and only ABCD remained. Okay, and when I find the inverse, okay, of this matrix, it gives me this particular matrix, which is 2 minus 2 1 1 minus 3 3 minus 2 minus 1 0 0 1 0 and 1 0 0 0 multiplied by the boundary condition, that is PK PK plus 1 DPK DPK plus 1. So this particular matrix I am calling it as M of H, okay, M of H, where M of H is the Hermite matrix, okay, is the inverse of the boundary constraint matrix. Okay, if I substitute this, okay, if I substitute this into P of U, so eventually I get, that is U cube U square U1 multiplied by this Hermite matrix multiplied by the boundary conditions. So finally we come up with this sort of equation. Okay, when I open this equation, okay, I get a very detailed equation of this kind, okay, wherein the equation tells me that it is a cubic equation, every term. So h0 of u, h1 of u, h2 of u and h3 of u, these are all cubic equations. That is, the polynomials are referred to as blending functions because they blend the boundary constraint values, that is endpoint coordinates and slopes, to obtain each coordinate position along the curve. So as you can see over here, this is the blending function representation on a graph, okay, blending function representation on a graph. And so I have h0 of u, okay, then that starts from 1, okay, in the y axis, and it comes to 1 at the x axis. Okay, I have h1 of u, which starts from 0 and it reaches 1 comma 1. Okay, I have h2 of u, that starts from x0 y0 and reaches x1, and then I have h3 of u, it starts from x0 y0 and it reaches x equal to 1. Okay, but it is exact opposite. Okay, it is exact opposite, or the mirror image of the h2. Okay, so this is the blending function, okay, that we derive from this. Okay, now how the question will be asked? The question will be asked based on the finding the typical point. Okay, they will specify whether a point given by coordinate, okay, is a midpoint of the cubic curve or not. Then they will also specify, for that they will specify these boundary conditions. Okay, or they will ask you to find out these points, okay, based on the boundary condition that is known to us, that is P of k at u0, then P of k plus 1, that is at u equal to 1, then derivative of P at u0 and derivative of P at u1. Okay, so these are the boundary conditions which we can easily find out. Okay, when we put this inside this matrix and solve the matrix, okay, we typically get a confirmation that whether the given set of coordinate point is lying on the curve or not. Okay, is lying on the curve or not. And this kind of study help us to formulate the parametric cubic curve, and also we can use this curve to generate a complex design. Okay, to generate a complex design. And in modern softwares, these curvatures are being given as a GUI button, wherein you can just go on placing the control points and the curve will get automatically generated. So that much control has been provided to the user, okay, that no mathematical calculation is expected from user, okay, who is using the 3D modeling tool. And by just placing the control points at the required location, he or she will be able to generate the required complex shape of the curve and do some design. Okay, do some design. These kind of things are also very helpful in automobile industry, wherein you require to come up with aerodynamic design shapes. Okay, even in aircraft industries. Okay, the missiles. Okay, then the bullets which gets fired from the guns. Okay, they also have to travel a very long distance at very rapid rate, and the requirement is that they should have less air friction while they are traveling, and their shape has to be aerodynamic. So in all these areas, okay, these kind of curvatures are very helpful, And I hope you have understood this. I'll see you next time with more such content of computer graphics and computer aided design. Thank you all.